The next part is sketch the positions of the mass and the string when the car is moving in the same direction at a constant velocity. So if a car is moving at a constant velocity, you mean there is no resultant force. Because an object moving at a constant speed or a constant velocity, it means it does not experience any resultant force. So as a result, what will be the position of the string and the object? So it will be at its equilibrium position as there is no resultant force, either in a horizontal or a vertical position. If undergo a much greater acceleration, so if undergo a greater acceleration, means greater change in speed, so greater resultant force. So if initial angle was 7, then this angle will be more than 7. And if it is decelerating, what will happen? What will the position? The car slow down? Because of inertia, what will the new position of the car? Initially, it was accelerating and now suddenly applies the brake or reduces the speed, so it is decelerating. So what will the position of the pendulum? So it will be towards the right-hand side. So here, there is no acceleration. That's why no resultant force, it will be at its mean position. Here we have a greater acceleration. So first, when it was accelerating, it was the angle with the vertical was 7. But now this angle will be more than 7. Any value, but more than 7. And now it is decelerating. Like, so direction of the resultant force will be opposite to the direction of the motion. So what will the new position of the pendulum? So it should be in opposite direction. They did not mention whether the acceleration is more than deceleration or less. That's why you can draw with any angle here, as it's not mentioned in this part. Explain why the string will not become horizontal, however greater the acceleration. What is the reason why the string will never be horizontal like this? The reason is that because the weight of a string or a weight of the object is acting downward. So there should be no resultant force. So there should always be a component of the tension which needed to balance with the weight. Like if it is exactly horizontal, there is no component of the tension to balance the weight. So it's practically impossible. As the weight is acting, so tension, there must be a component of a tension which always balances with the weight. Like one is t cosine, the one which is with an angle, and the against angle is t sine. Because if it was a weightlessness, like example, there was no weight for this object, in that case, it will always be horizontal because there is no weight acting. But now, all the cases the weight is acting, that's why there must always be a component of a tension which balances with the weight, so it can never be horizontal. Suggest why many devices contain three accelerometers arranged right angle to each other. So to identify basically which direction the, like, because we have three dimension motion. We have, like, we can move in X direction, we can move Y direction, and we can move in Z direction. That's why to determine the acceleration in all the three dimensions, there are always the accelerometer which are 90 degree to each other. So why many devices contain three accelerometers arranged right angle to identify, as we have, or we are in three dimension. So to determine the direction of acceleration in any dimension, that's why they all place 90 degree or perpendicular to each other. Like between X and Y, it's 90, between Y and Z, it's 90, and between Z and X is also 90. So that's why they are all placed 90 degree to each other. Then next is, this was question 23, page 23, 4, then 27. Actually, 26 and 27 are related, so I will discuss. Apply Newton's law of motion to explain three observations in experiment 2. We have a stack of a coin. The coin is flicked towards the stack. Like a single coin is flicked towards the stack of a coin. And we observe the bottom coin is knocked out from the under stack and the flip coin stops. And it So we have to explain this motion like in terms of Newton's law. So basically what is happening initially, why the bottom coin is moving? Because this bottom coin is experiencing the force. Like bottom coin has an unbalanced force. That's why it starts to move or it accelerates. And according to Newton's third law, that action and reaction forces are equal but opposite in direction. So, first observation, why this coin start to move. So, the flick coin exert a force on the coin which is at the bottom. And as a result, the coin which is there at the bottom will also apply a force on the flick coin. And the two forces, according to Newton's third law, two forces, action and reaction forces, are equal but opposite in direction. So when there's a force on the coin which was stationary initially, like the bottom coin which was stationary initially, that force will produce an acceleration, so it will move out. This flick coin, what will happen, why it slow down? According to Newton's third law, there's a reaction force. And that reaction force is opposite to direction of the motion. So if the force is direct opposite to direction of the motion, so it will decelerate or it will stop. So it's like causing the stationary coin to move and a moving coin to stop. And why? Because according to Newton's third law, the two forces are equal but opposite in the directions. And then why the stack? They mentioned that the stack dropped down. So remaining of this stack, why it drops down? So for remaining of the stack, it does not experience any horizontal force. It only experiences the weight which was acting downwards. So it only experiences the force due to the gravity. That's why it will accelerate downward. Or it dropped down, you can also mention. So the distribution of the marks, when you mention the coin which is moving experience unbalanced force, that is one mark. And or you can start with a Newton's third law, action and reaction forces equal and opposite in direction, that score one mark. So the direction, the stationary coin experience a resultant force, it accelerate, and the moving coil experience a resultant force opposite to direction of the motion, that will decelerate. So this way you will have the four marks. And then the remaining step is stack. It moved downward because it does not experience any horizontal force. So only the unbalanced force or the resultant force in downward or a vertical, that's why it moved downward. Then carrying out the stack coin experiment, the student sometime observed that the flick coin did not stop, but it changes the direction. Suggest a reason for this observation, why the flick coin, it changes the direction. So basically what might happen, if you say you're looking from the top, first collision was the stack coin. This is an example, the stack coin. And this one, like the stack coin. And this one is a moving, the flicked coin. So first, what was happening, like first example, when they collide with each other, the direction of the motion of the stack, the motion of the flick coin is towards right. And when they collide, the direction of the resultant force, like the pair force, is opposite to the direction of the motion. That's why this will slow down or decelerate, and this will accelerate or speed up. But some cases, what we observe when the coin come in contact, it changes the direction. So what might be the reason for that? So maybe it's not a collide, maybe it collide in this manner. So when it collide in this manner, like this is the direction of the motion for the flick coin, and you can see the direction, this time the direction of the motion is not, when they collide with each other, what will the direction of the pair force? This will be the direction of the pair force. So in this, the direction of the pair force create a resultant, and then it's not same as the direct or opposite to direction of the motion. So when it is not exactly opposite to direction of the motion, that's why it causes a change in direction. So if the flick coin is moving in this way, like the stack coin move in this way, the flick coin move in a specific direction. So the idea is that because this time the resultant force is not opposite to the direction of the motion, that's why it causes a change in direction. Is it clear, this one?